Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Group President, Enterprise Products and Services, Symantec, Francis deSouza.
A businessman on a trip had his smartphone tampered with and compromised, and the information stolen from his smartphone was used to infiltrate his company's network and then used as a staging ground to attack a number of government agencies that his company did business with. The small business owner came into work one day and found that his entire staff was locked out of their IT infrastructure, and he had a voicemail letting him know that cybercriminals had taken over his small business, and that if he wired over $800,000 to the criminals, they would let him back in. Otherwise, they would delete his corporate data. Faced with no choice, the small business owner managed to negotiate the criminals down to $600,000 and was able to get access back to his corporate assets. If you read the newspapers today, you'll see that the United States House Intelligence Committee, as part of the United States Congress, deemed switches and routers from the Chinese manufacturer Huawei as national security threats and said that those switches and routers could be used as a platform to launch a crippling attack on the national infrastructure of the United States. Now, whether you believe that's true or just election year posturing, it's very clear that cybersecurity looks different today than it did even a year ago. And so what I'm going to do here is share with you some of the research that we have at Symantec around what we are seeing from the threat landscape perspective. Now, we at Symantec have a unique vantage point around what's going on in the threat landscape because we run one of the largest global intelligence networks in the world. We have probes in over 200 countries and territories, and on a daily basis, we deal with between 1.5 and 3 billion security events. Not only do we gather 42 different types of security information from those 200 countries and territories, but we've built on the back end one of the largest, if not the largest, big data infrastructure to munch that security information and give us insights into what's going on, leveraging 1.5 trillion pieces of data to calculate a security verdict on 145 million domains, URLs, and files. And we do that every 6 hours. And so what I'm going to share with you here is research from our intelligence network. It's a lot of research that, frankly, we haven't published yet. And I'm going to use it to form the basis of three questions. One is, what does a cyber attack look like today? Two, what are the targets of these attacks that we are protecting? And then three, what are the elements of an effective cybersecurity strategy today? Now, while we're looking at the threat landscape through our global intelligence network, we at Symantec are also looking at the targets. We are looking at the corporate IT environments and how those are evolving. And it's no exaggeration to say that corporate IT is going through a massive transformation, arguably the biggest transformation we've seen in corporate IT in a very long time. You talk to any IT professional today, and they'll tell you that their IT infrastructure today is more complex than it's been in a very long time. In a lot of cases, it's just simply bigger. In fact, two of the five largest construction projects in the world going on right now are data centers. Not only are data centers larger than ever before, but IT environments are more heterogeneous than ever before. As an IT industry, we went through a period where we were standardizing. We were standardizing the image on the endpoints. These are the laptops you can have. These are the PCs you can have. And we were standardizing and consolidating data centers. Well, that pendulum has shifted. And it shifted to a point where IT will tell you that they have more heterogeneous storage, servers, operating systems, hypervisors, and endpoints than they've ever had to deal with. Most troublingly, they'll tell you that they have less control over IT than they've ever had. And this is playing out on two different forms. On the endpoint side, the way it's playing out is this phenomenon known as BYOD, bring your own device. People are bringing their own smartphones, their own tablets to work, and then they're using them to access corporate assets. In the data center, the way this phenomenon is playing out is that business users are starting to use public networks, cloud-based services like Salesforce.com for CRM, but also things like Facebook and Twitter for marketing. And so IT has really no control over that data as it sits in the third-party data centers. But while they have less control than ever, with all the regulations that are emerging, they're actually liable for all corporate data, wherever it lives, for the security of that data and for the privacy of that data. And so you talk to IT, they'll tell you that they're facing a more toxic threat environment than they ever have. Their IT infrastructures are more complex, more heterogeneous than they've ever been. They have less control than they've ever had. And the cost of being wrong continues to go up. So it's clear that their security model that they've used so far isn't going to get them through the next phase that they're facing. And so as we thought about what is the right model for security going forward, we looked elsewhere for metaphors. And the first place we looked was conventional kinetic warfare. You talk to a soldier and they'll tell you that it's almost impossible to win a battle by doing defense only. And that's what we've been doing in cybersecurity. They'll tell you that it's essential to have a strong defensive capability, but that it's equally important to have an offense that can strike back on the enemy and also strike back on their critical supply lines, which in some case is even more important than a direct attack on their enemy. Now, that's not a new principle, right? A lot of you here are familiar with Aikido. Well, Aikido is a martial art that's predicated on the idea of using the energy of your opponent for advantage for yourself. When an Aikido master is attacked, he doesn't dodge or strike back. What the Aikido master does is he enters into and blends with the attack. And by getting into the mind of the enemy and understanding the motivations of the energy of the enemy, and equally importantly, the energy flow associated with the attack, the Aikido master is able to understand different avenues for defense. Now, what does that have to do with cybersecurity and how we should be thinking about cybersecurity? Well, one of the things that we've started to do is think about the whole attack that's being run on an organization. And that's a fundamentally different way for us in an industry to think about cybersecurity. Because the way we've done it, frankly, for decades is we've looked at individual attacks. We've looked at this piece of malware and said, okay, for this piece of malware, you need this protection. So you have virus, you need antivirus. You have spam, you need anti-spam. Spyware, well, you get the idea, right? And we're changing that. We're saying, look, it's not about the bullet and getting the right bulletproof vest. We need to take a step back and understand the campaign that launched that bullet and understand the adversary that ran that campaign that launched that bullet. Because perhaps if you understand what they're actually trying to do, you'll understand a different way of defending against that attack. And so we start to think about the entire campaigns. And when we started to do that at Symantec, we noticed that the campaigns being run have several new characteristics over the last few months. So I want to talk about that a little bit. One of the things we've noticed, for example, is the emergence of what we at Symantec are calling the multi-flank attack. What's a multi-flank attack? It's an attack where several different, seemingly independent attacks are launched by a single adversary on a target. And in fact, the intent of some of those attacks is purely diversionary, right? So now we as a group know about distributed denial of service attacks, DDoS attacks. In fact, it was the preferred form of attack by some of the hacktivist groups over the last couple of years. It's a blunt instrument. They launch a DDoS attack with the intent to cripple a network. And it's, in fact, the main attack that they're running. But in the last few months, we've seen DDoS attacks take on a different role. They've gone from being that blunt force attack to being actually a sophisticated diversionary tactic that cyber criminals are using to obfuscate the real attack that's happening at the same time. Now, let's talk about why does that work? And why does it work especially in industries like financial services industries? Well, it works because of something that psychologists call inattentional blindness. It's the failure to recognize unexpected stimuli, even if it's dramatic and in plain sight. There's some pioneering work done by two researchers, Daniel Simons out of the University of Illinois, and Christopher Chabri out of Harvard University. And what they did, both psychologists, what they did was they ran what they called an awareness test. And they filmed two teams playing basketball, one team wearing white, another team wearing black. And then they asked a bunch of observers to look at the video and count how many times the white team got the ball. So people watched the video and they had to count how many times the white team got the ball. What they found actually at the end of watching the video is that most observers ended up correctly getting the number of times the white team got the ball. But 50% of observers missed the fact that in the middle of the game, a gorilla came onto the basketball court and started dancing. 50% were so busy counting the passes that they missed quite literally the 800-pound gorilla in front of them. Now, how does that happen? What psychologists state is that very often, especially when you're inundated with a lot of data, the mind becomes very myopic, and it focuses on a specific thing, and it looks for an expected pattern. And so when something happens that's not an expected pattern or is not that specific thing they're looking at, it's astonishing how the mind can just block it out and focus on the task in hand. Now, I would argue that that's a very important lesson for us in security, because we are facing a lot of data too, and the criminals know that. And in fact, they know that in industries like financial services, where they are inundated with a lot of data, their tactics, their diversionary tactics, are actually more likely to work. So that's one thing they're taking advantage of in a multi-flank attack. The next thing they're taking advantage of, and this is in the spirit again like DDoS of what's old becoming new again, is phishing attacks, but highly advanced phishing attacks. And what's underpinning this is the amount of information available today on social networking sites. In one attack that we saw, the cyber criminals knew that a particular IT administrator that they were targeting had four children and, from reading the Facebook site, knew that they were planning a vacation. And so what the criminals did was they sent a phishing attack to that IT administrator offering discounted travel insurance for families that had three kids or more. Well, guess what? That phishing attack worked. The IT administrator clicked on the link and brought malware into the organization and kicked off the steps to a cyber attack. And so, and in fact, our teams in preparing for this actually gave me an example of a phishing attack that they would use on me. So looking at my LinkedIn profile and Facebook, they know that my brother is the CEO of a health company, and they put together an email that would look like it came from him, talking about a study they were doing, and showed me that this is the kind of stuff that is available publicly, and that's the kind of email that would be highly, be likely for them to send to me with a higher chance of me clicking on the link. So we're talking about multi-flank attacks that are taking advantage of diversionary tactics and advanced phishing techniques. So what I'm going to do now is actually talk you through a campaign that we saw recently run against a bunch of European regional banks. Right? The attack actually started through a phishing attack. And it was a phishing attack against IT administrators in the regional banks. Same thing, an advanced phishing attack led by a very targeted email. The phishing attack was successful, malware got into the banks, and the malware was designed to steal logon credentials and then send it back to the attackers. Once the criminals had those logon credentials, what they did was then launched a DDoS attack against the banks. And what they would do is launch the attacks late on a Friday afternoon. And they would do that because they knew at that point, chances are, the IT department was thinly staffed. And that once the DDoS attack was launched, the IT department predictably would move their IT security resources to deal with the DDoS attack, because they were worried about the urgent starvation of bandwidth and compute that was going to take away resources and potentially bring down their website. And so they had their security professionals focused on the DDoS attack and keeping their website up. While this was happening, the cyber criminals then launched the real attack. And the real attack in this case was to come into the environment and steal credit card information, debit card information, and ATM information. Once they had done that, they actually handed over the attack to the monetization team within that cyber criminal gang. And what the monetization team did was actually created ATM cards, debit cards, and credit cards. And they handed those cards out to money mules. Now, money mules are individual contractors hired by the cyber criminal gang. and they're around the world. And what they do, their whole job is to take those debit cards or ATM cards and go to ATMs and drain the accounts. Now, typically, these are individuals. They're not long-term affiliated with the gang. They're specifically hired for that particular purpose. And in fact, they usually don't know about the rest of the campaign. In fact, our intelligence actually shows that when money mules are recruited, one of the criteria that this gang used was they were looking for individuals with low IQs. And they had a test specifically checking for that. Because what they didn't want was anybody who would figure out the rest of the attack. All right? So now, just because the individuals may have lower than average IQs, though, it doesn't mean that the ATM attack is not sophisticated. In one case, it was so sophisticated and coordinated that within a couple of hour period, money mules went to ATMs in 46 cities around the world. So Moscow, Dubai, London, New York, Atlanta, Los Angeles, and drained $9 million in that couple of hour period. The next step, once you've got the money, is how do you get it back to the cybercriminal gang? Now, it used to be, even up to a few months ago, that it was literally walked back. So people would carry it in bags and transport it back physically as they were traveling on planes with the money. But what they found was they started running into a pretty old school adversary, dogs. So in countries like Argentina, for example, the officials at the airport started using cash sniffing dogs to walk around and look for people that were carrying duffel bags filled with cash. And so in the last few months, we've seen an evolution of their strategies to use wire services and new internet currencies like Bitcoin. And so what you can see is that in these attacks, there's a highly sophisticated overall campaign run by the gang, and that there are many, many steps associated with making this successful. Now, they do a number of things to increase the chances of them being successful, right? In a lot of cases, for example, they'll target the bank accounts of small businesses because they know that small businesses reconcile their accounts less quickly than large industries. In some cases, when they steal credit card numbers, they won't actually create credit cards. What they'll do is they'll run a series of small charges against the credit cards. And they'll mimic the user behavior pattern. They'll typically do it during the week rather than weekdays because they found that people are more vigilant over the week, over the weekends around what gets charged to their credit cards. So what are the implications for us? Well, if you think about how you want to protect yourself against these attacks, you'll realize that this isn't about protecting just the DDoS attack, right? And that the most effective way of stopping the attack may not be once they're in, but it may actually be looking end-to-end at the whole attack, and we'll come back to that. The next question we spent some time on at Symantec was trying to figure out how, as a cyber criminal, do you create the infrastructure to launch this attack? And because the reality is, to launch an attack, you'll need a lot of storage, a lot of compute resources, a lot of bandwidth, right? And you have some of the most sophisticated organizations in the world, Interpol, the FBI, a number of the agencies around Europe, all looking for you. So how do you run a large data center and be invisible at the same time? Right? Now, it used to be that the way they did it was they would look for countries that had an advanced telecommunications infrastructure but didn't have an advanced regulatory framework around cybercrime. But the reality is the number of those countries has dwindled. And so how do you do it? How do you create this massive data center with this huge amount of compute resources and still stay invisible? And how much does it cost? Well, our research suggests that it costs $85 a month, right? And if you look at this ad on one of the hacker boards, you'll see what I'm talking about. What's happened is we've seen recently the emergence of a specialized network hosting industry. And what they do is they offer bulletproof operations. And they offer bulletproof operations specifically for the purpose of hosting criminal attacks. Now, the industry has emerged quickly and has become incredibly competitive. And so you're seeing a huge amount of price pressure, which results in a pretty sophisticated environment for only $85 a month. Now, how do they do it? Well, in one case, the way it was set up was the company was a South American company. It was running a botnet hosting infrastructure in Eastern Europe, but actually using botnet-infected PCs around the world as part of the attack, and it was manned by people on the ground in Asia. Now, you can see the layer upon layer of insulation that's being added, which makes it really hard for even the most sophisticated law enforcement agencies to get at the people doing it. Now, these are sophisticated organizations, right? They have marketing. You saw the marketing in the hacker boards. They have sales. They have online ad optimization. They have data center operations. So who are these people? Well, in a lot of cases, what we're finding is they're able to hire IT staff. They look for example, IT staff that have been laid off and are disgruntled. They're also, especially nowadays, looking for people that have online ad experience. All right, and I talked about the fact that, look, this is a business just like any other business, and what they want to do is try and get customers and beat out other criminal gangs that are competing for the same customers. And so a very marketable skill in the hacker world right now is online ad sales background. So what are they relying on? Well, they're relying on the fact that the targets, corporate IT, sets up their IT infrastructure as a bunch of silos. And that these silos very often have their own tools. So you'll have a web security team or a firewall team, or you'll have a GRC team. And these teams, don't talk to each other very much. I was talking to one chief information security officer here in London, and he said, look, I have over 135 security products in my environment. And those are run by 24 security teams across my organization. But in the end, he said, I don't feel secure, right? And he's right. Because the reality is that the criminals have a lot more organization and information sharing than he does in his own environment. And that's a lesson we need to think about, and I'll come back to that. The next thing that we're seeing from a threat landscape perspective is the emergence of what we're calling the dark powers, to use a science fiction term. Now, what is that? And Art talked about it a little bit, which is the idea that it used to be that if you thought about the most sophisticated cyber attacks, you know, the cyber war, the cyber espionage, well, frankly, there were only a dozen countries in the world, and it was the countries that had the multi-hundred billion dollar, the trillion dollar defense budgets that were capable of mounting those attacks. But in the last year to 18 months, we've seen a democratization of cyber warfare, if you like. And what we're seeing is now countries below that top dozen that are able to get access to very sophisticated cyber weapons. And in fact, we're seeing criminals also being able to get access to those sophisticated cyber weapons. And what we're finding is that today, you don't need an advanced Navy or an Air Force or an Army to launch a pretty devastating attack on another country or another organization. And so if we look at the actors in the threat landscape, what we're finding is because of the emergence of all these contractors, because of the open sourcing of cyber weapons, we're seeing the emergence of a whole other tier of dark powers that are able to launch incredibly sophisticated attacks. So while all that's going on, if you look at the targets, the biggest trend we're seeing there, other than the loss of control, is just the amount of information that corporate IT has to deal with continuing to grow exponentially. We are digitizing our lives, we're digitizing our businesses, and that's creating an awful lot of target area for these criminals to go after. In 2011, it's estimated that there was 1.9 zettabytes of information in the world, zettabyte being 10 to the power of 21. Now, that number, according to IDC, is expected to go to 7.8 zettabytes by 2015, and that number is going to grow by a factor of 40 by 2020. So we're seeing an explosion in the amount of information that we're trying to protect against this increasingly sophisticated threat landscape. So how do we do it? Well, here I'm going to go back to conventional kinetic warfare. In the military, they use a term called left of bang. And that's a term that I think we need to start using more in cybersecurity. Bang, well, bang is the bad incident that you're trying to avoid. It's the bomb explosion in the military. It's the robbery in law enforcement. And what they're telling us is that right of bang is the set of actions that you do after the incident has occurred. For us, that's our cyber response teams, right? It's how we deal with the 2 million credit card records that have been stolen and the process we have to kick off to notify people that their information and their privacy has been breached. It's the small business that has to write the check for $500,000 to get back the access to their own corporate infrastructure. The actions you take right of breach, well, they're urgent. They're defensive. They're oftentimes disorganized and chaotic, and they are expensive. Now, the reality is, all of us as cybersecurity professionals are going to spend some of our time right of bang. It's the life we chose, it's the nature of the work we do. But the reality is, we are much better off if we can focus left of bang, before the incident occurs. And the good news is, as we looked at the entire campaign that a criminal may be running, the reality is there's a lot of space there left of bang. Because for that attack to complete and be effective, there are a lot of steps that criminals must go through. And usually, we're reacting to the things they want us to react to, right? It's the DDoS attack. We're reacting to where they are the strongest. But if you really spend your time left of bang and you understand the whole campaign, you can understand where they are weak. And you can start to take an offense approach on the criminals themselves. So what does left of bang look like? Well, first thing about being left of bang is you have to have intelligence. You have to understand the campaigns that are being run, where the weak spots are, what to look for, and you've got to know yourself. You've got to know your targets. What are your high-value assets that are likely to be targets? Where are they? How are they being protected? And then you need to really focus on specifically the information assets, because those are the assets that are the most valuable to criminals and also among the most portable. So they're the easiest for criminals to attack. Now, the challenge with information is not all information is created equal. Right, I was talking to one chief information security officer who said, look, Francis, I know at least half the information in my environment, actually probably 90% is garbage. Right? It's multiple copies of the same PowerPoint, it's junk mail, it's newsletters, and really only 10% or less of the information in my environment is really important. And frankly, I'd love nothing more than to delete all the garbage. The challenge is, I don't know which 50% that is. Right? And it turns out that for security especially, knowing whether this is a newsletter or an MRI, well, it makes a really big difference when you think about security for your environment. And so as we think about living left of bang, I'd argue that the first most important thing is to make sure you have sophisticated intelligence. And that's two parts. There's obviously the intelligence around what's happening outside your environment in a way that's relevant for you. And here I think the mind change, the big change that's going to have to happen in the security industry is not to focus on the bullets. The security industry needs to change. This isn't the game of this bullet requires this bulletproof vest. This is a game of who's attacking us, what's the campaign they're running, what are the weak spots in their campaign, and then let me know what to look for, because you know what? That piece of malware may be nothing, but if it's on a server that has critical information on it, well, it may be something. If that DDoS attack happens, could be nothing, or if it's happening at the same time as something else is going on, could be something else. So understand what's going on, and again, move from bullets to campaigns and actors. And then two, know yourself, right? Understand what's going on in your own environment. Where are your assets? What's happening to them as they move within your environment and in and out of your environment? The next thing to focus on is agility. Now, when I say agility, everybody immediately gets, oh yeah, we need to respond more quickly. And sure, you need to respond more quickly. But if you think about it, an attack doesn't happen like this, right? There are multiple steps to an attack. So in addition to being able to respond more quickly, the thing nobody talks about, which I think we need to spend more time on, is be able to react to the unexpected, right? If you think about inattentional blindness, it's the inability to even see something that we didn't expect. So what I mean by agility is slightly different than just move faster. It means be able to understand the unexpected that's happening in your environment and reconfigure your security to deal with the unexpected. So for example, If you have virtualized your data center environment, well, you know with vMotion, what happens is a lot of your compute is being moved across servers, right? Well, what if part of your critical application infrastructure moves onto a server that isn't hardened? That's an unexpected situation, right? Are you able to reconfigure your security in a dynamic way to deal with that happening? Because frankly, that's a scenario you want to support, right? To maintain the availability of your environment. So the second critical component of a well-thought-through cybersecurity strategy is agility. The next thing is, if this is warfare, it's power, right? You've got to make sure that you have the strength in your defenses, right? That it does matter, frankly, whether you have a great anti-spam solution or a good anti-spam solution, because we saw that phishing attacks are forming a part of these attacks, right? In fact, it's probably one of the parts where the attackers are the most vulnerable, right? It does matter whether your antivirus solution is good or not, right? It does matter, because malware is a part of the attack too, and that's probably a difference between the way I think and maybe some of the talks you heard earlier, because I do think antivirus matters, because if you looked at the whole campaign, they do come in with there, right? And I'm not saying it's the whole strategy, but there are many steps to this attack, right? And look for where they are weak. And in the end, that's a spot that they are weak too. One of the things we pioneered at Symantec is this idea of reputation-based security. We're the only company in the world that realized that, look, these new attacks are based on custom malware. They're writing malware for you, but they'll never use again. So any other company that uses a signature-based approach to antivirus, well, that'll never work against custom malware. So with reputation-based security, what we're able to do is say, have we seen this file anywhere else in the world? We protect 1 billion systems. If we've never seen this file, well, then it's suspicious, right? And what we're doing then is looking for the weak spot in the attack and turning the tables on the attacker that says, we're gonna force you to put that malware on many, many machines. And you know what? Then our conventional ways will catch it, right? So again, understand the whole campaign and have powerful defenses all along the way. So that's sort of a whirlwind tour, if you like, around what are we seeing as the new threats in cybersecurity? You know, what are the targets that they're going after? And then finally, what are the components of an effective cybersecurity strategy? The world has changed a lot in the last year, since we were last here for RSA, and I'm looking forward to coming back next year and giving you an update. Thank you very much.